Hello, my name is Antonio Papano. I'm a patron of the Keyboard Charitable Trust. I was born in Britain. I've lived and studied in America and now divide my time mostly as music director of the Royal Opera House Covent Garden here in London and the Santa Cecilia Orchestra and Chorus in Rome. Music has no borders and the Keyboard Trust neither. Over its long history, it has presented young concert pianists of 34 different nationalities, offering them performing opportunities internationally and now globally by means of these internet broadcasts. All are ready to grace the great concert halls. I now invite you to hear them in conversation and in concert. Please remember their names, then ask the Keyboard Trust to send them to perform where you are. Then you too will have helped to accomplish our true mission. Thank you very much.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Elena Vorotko, and I welcome you to the Keyboard Charitable Trust's New Artist Recital. I'm very happy to be here at St. Matthew's Church in Ealing, and as a trust, we are grateful and blessed to be able to carry on the work that was set out for the trust 30 years ago. Narretta Conchi and John Leach started this trust to help young musicians bridge the gap between higher education and proper career. So the trust provides opportunities for young pianists to perform and also provides a reasonable fee so they can afford to carry on developing as artists. I would very much like to say a big thank you to our loyal and generous audience for always being there for the artists and allowing us to carry on this work. Thank you very much. Today's artist is Victor Maslov. He comes from Russia with stellar Russian musical education and vast performance experience, so you are in for a treat. He will perform for you Bach's Toccata in E minor, Haydn B minor Sonata, and Mussorgsky's Pictures at an Exhibition. Afterwards, we will have an informal discussion about his life, his repertoire, and his interests, so please stay on for that. And last but not least, I would like to wholeheartedly thank our devoted recording engineer, Roy Emerson, for always being here and for enabling us to deliver these online recitals to you. And now please welcome Victor Maslov.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure to have informal conversation now with Victor Maslov, who has just performed the most outstanding recital. Thank you so much from all of us at the Keyboard Charitable Trust.
Thank you.
It was such a pleasure. And to me personally, it was so striking that the style of each piece was so clearly defined and expressed, from articulation you used to dynamic range, and the sort of sound you used for each piece was like a completely different world.
Thank you very much for such a generous words about my playing, and very pleased to do this recital.
Well, it was very clear, and I'm sure our audience will agree. When I was listening to your Bach, I was wondering if you had in your mind the sound of an organ, or perhaps harpsichord, maybe both, maybe neither. What was your thinking?
It's a very, very interesting question, because this particular toccata is quite rich for different characters, and I would say probably even different tempers I needed for every single little piece of the toccata. And I can say that last movement, the actual toccata, for me is definitely an organ, mm-hmm. because of different registers, high pitch, low pitch, and for me it's different registers of the organ. Probably the penultimate movement is more like a harpsichord, because it's more in improvisation way, mm-hmm. and I find it more like a musician just playing for himself, improvising. It's interesting with the second movement, the little fugato, mm-hmm. because strangely enough, I myself hear it a little bit orchestral, uh-huh. maybe with some woodwinds, some very clear timbres, and I don't know if it's right thing to say about this moment. Yeah. And the very beginning is maybe again harpsichord, because it's like an opening a book, like very welcoming piece of music. Let's listen to something.
Well, I'm sure our audience will go back now and listen to the Bach again and say, actually, I can really hear the organ at the beginning of the fugue, which I thought exactly those thoughts. Wow, this is really sounds like an organ. Actually, physically sounds like an organ.
Thank you.
You have achieved it. And it's really fascinating just how much depth and range of sound one can get out of the modern piano, but with the help of the knowledge of other instruments as well. Talking of which, in the Haydn, what was interesting to me is that your dynamics never went above about mezzo forte, but certainly went further down than you would normally expect. Again, did you have any experience on playing historical instruments, like maybe a fortepiano or harpsichord?
Yeah, Haydn is absolutely different music world, obviously, and this sonata, I have a long history with this sonata. I had a chance to try this sonata on a harpsichord, actually, in my school years in Moscow, in the Gnessin Music School. I had a 2-year course with a very important Russian harpsichordist, Olga Martinova, and obviously it helps to think of the sound world even when I play on the piano. And I took some decisions on volume and on tempi in this sonata, especially in order to underline some little details which I think may get lost if the tempo is faster, if the loudness is bigger. And that was my approach.
It certainly really helped to appreciate the little detail in the first movement, especially. I mean, the second movement was just divine. you can tell I'm a bit of a fan now.
Oh, thank you.
But the first movement was strangely slower than what most people do. Some people played way faster than sort of the average, but yours was relatively slower. And I was surprised to actually hear some things I didn't really pay much attention to before. I mean, I played this piece myself. But you really made us listen, which I think is really, really important for a communicator, for a performer.
Well, I'm very glad I achieved that, because I played this sonata for quite a few years, I would say, and previously my approach was more general, like sort of way faster, more projective, sort of looking for Beethoven somewhere.
Yes. Yeah.
And quite recently, I was just practicing, and out of nowhere, I played it slowly, and I was quite impressed by how many details I showed to myself when I had this time to check for it. And since then, I started playing much, much slower, and I find it interesting, at least for myself, and hopefully for the audience as well. That's how it happened.
Yes, well, you see, with the, even the first statement in the first movement is usually quite bold and quite loud, because it's forte, so everybody does their Rachmaninoff-style attack. But you did it more even with the sound tone, not even the volume, but the intention of the, not even an attack, but the, how would you call it, approach to the key was meaningful and expressive of that emotion rather than just volume. Because the volume can be a bit of an empty substance, you know, not really giving us specific emotion. It's just loud. Whereas forte really is an indication of an emotion of some kind, and you were able to project that without being loud.
Very, very big compliment.
Which is interesting, yeah. Now, the pictures of an at an exhibition, I was thinking about it. It's one of those really fascinating situations when the artist, Hartmann, has, being a big fan of everything truly Russian, if such a thing exists, was very keen on really using the folk art in his work. And he interpreted certain ideas in his art, which then Mussorgsky saw and commented on that art through his music. And then you pick up the piece of music and interpret it that to us through your performance. So it's kind of three-tier, at least, of transfer of information. And I was just wondering, how did you come to settle on those particular ways of portraying the different pictures? Did you research the originals? Did you perhaps find some other art inspiring? What did you do to prepare?
Yeah, continuing your commentary about this chain of artist, composer, interpreter, it's quite easy to fall into broken phone trap, isn't it?
That's what I was going to say, yes, absolutely.
Yeah, so all these, the biggest hopes and biggest struggle not to do this broken phone, it's very dangerous. And answering your question, of course we know the original paintings by Hartmann, and but I must say that Mussorgsky, in his sense of Russian soul, Russian thing,
yes.
Russianness, if we can say that,
yeah.
For me is one of the biggest Russian composers, if you say. Unfortunately, he only wrote some miniatures for piano, and this is the only big cycle from Mussorgsky.
Mm-hmm.
But his operas is something incredible.
Yes,
if you want to understand the Russian mindset, Russian soul, Russian heart, watch Boris Godunov, watch Havanchik.
Yeah.
Everything is so perfect there.
Mm.
That is Russia. And of course, for me, biggest inspiration is other music of Mussorgsky, one of my favorite composers. I was born in Russia, I was raised in Russia, so I'm quite familiar with Russian culture.
Right. Yes, it's easier, isn't it?
Yeah, obviously it's easier, and of course I can imagine all these ideas of these pictures, because maybe Mussorgsky, of course he was inspired by specific paintings, but he was giving something else into them. For me, absolutely like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope I get close to understand.
Well, it was literally like seeing different pictures in front of you. The images were so vivid and so clearly portrayed. It was just interesting to note, just to myself again, that the difference between the pretty little design for a Russian-style clock, which then turned into the vicious Baba Yaga, you know, the Russian witch, which is the terror of all Russian folk fairy tales, and the catacombs as well. On the painting, it's not actually very much, just a few people kind of standing around with a bit of an arch. Nothing too dark or mysterious, really, but what Mussorgsky puts on the page is something quite different.
Yeah, but you said about this catacombs. It's interesting because if you try to play about this few people and just the broken building, it gets a little bit. For me, it's who is not anymore in this painting. Mm. This feeling, they are not there, and these buildings will never be built back. It's done, and that's what's interesting about this music.
Yes, it was very, it was quite shocking actually in a way, because suddenly time stopped, and it was just so still, and again you had that space to work out what it is you're feeling, you know. So it's fascinating how music can really influence the inner works of the listener. So yes, I think I'm more or less running out of my questions here. One question I wanted to ask you, the New York Concert Review has called you as one of those artists who is very close to all-round mastery of his repertoire, which I wouldn't disagree with. But presumably you do have some of your favorites, despite you playing mostly everything perfectly.
you make me blush. Of course, Russian music is something which is naturally very close to me, and Mussorgsky, Tchaikovsky, Rachmaninoff is definitely the favorite. And with Rachmaninoff, some people think that it's just loud passages and chords, and my goal, my life goal is to destroy this thought forever, because Rachmaninoff is so much more than just chords and passages.
Lots of passages there.
Lots of
notes. Yeah.
Inside of those passages. Of course, 20th century Russian Soviet composers, Prokofiev,
yeah.
Stravinsky abroad. Mm-hmm. So this is naturally very, very close to me. German Romantics.
Mm-hmm.
Schumann, Brahms, Schubert.
Oh
my God, Schubert. I must say that maybe classical period is something I need to work on.
Mm-hmm.
I do love this music, but it's something which is not very natural to me. So
mm-hmm.
I have to work in order to approach some decent result. That would be my answer. Baroque music, of course, but also this requires some work to be done.
Well, you know, to each their own, right?
Yes.
So, depending on your personality. Right. Now, we've talked a lot about the music. What about the non-musical time when you're not at the piano, if that ever happens? What do you like to do?
Yeah, not that much time. But now, since the pandemic started, we have so much time.
Yeah, so you started knitting?
Fortunately, not. That's too precise.
Well, you're doing well with precision.
Yeah. I would say that when I'm over the piano, my favorite thing is just to drive my mind, to relax my mind. Movies. I like all sorts of from very important Tarkovsky, very much,
mm-hmm.
but to very funny things of new times.
Mm-hmm.
Just to get off of music and relax. I would say reading.
Mm-hmm.
I recently started reading.
Yeah.
I had a long gap, but doing. And I do like football. If I have time to watch football, obviously I would like to. And but what I do the most, all of the time, is online chess. I'm addicted
really?
To this. Yes. Sometimes I practice, and then I stop practice and just play a quick game. I do like it. I'm horrible though. But
well, it's as they say, the best way to relax is to change your.
Yeah,
activity.
Absolutely. I'm totally agree with this thought.
Yeah. Well, it is absolutely wonderful to talk to you. Thank you very much for your time, and thank you again for the most exhilarating experience today.
Thank you very, very much. It's been my great pleasure.